Hello everyone, this is Ashraf Hassanpour from Shiraz University of Medical Sciences, Anatomical Department. Welcome to today's lecture about human ear anatomy. The ear is a purely sensory organ specialized for the sensation of hearing and balance. The ear is an energy transducer, which means that it converts acoustic energy into the electrochemical energy and plays an important role in maintaining the balance of the body. We will talk about the ear in terms of the basic elements involved: the outer ear, the middle ear, and the inner ear. Let us start by looking at the structures of the external or outer ear. The outer ear is composed of two basic components with which you are quite familiar: the pinna or auricle and the external acoustic meatus. The pinna or auricle has several important functions, including aiding the localization of the sound in space and capturing sound energy. Landmarks of the pinna are important for a number of reasons, not the least of which is their diagnostic significance for some genetic conditions. The helix forms the curved margin of the pinna, marking its most distal borders. The superior posterior bulge on the helix is known as the auricle tubercle or Darwin's tubercle. Immediately anterior to the helix is the antihelix, a similar fold of tissue marking the entrance to the concha. Between the helix and antihelix is the scaphoid fossa. The antihelix bifurcates superiorly, producing the superior crus and inferior crus, and the space between them forms the triangular fossa. The symphyconchi is the anterior extension of the helix, marking the anterior entrance to the concha, and the cavum conchi is the deep portion of the concha. The concha is the entrance to the ear canal. A flap of epithelium-covered cartilage, known as tragus, looks as if it could cover the entrance to the meatus, and probably did in an earlier version of the auditory mechanism. Posterior and inferior to the tragus is the antitragus. The region between tragus and antitragus is termed the intertragic notch, and below the antitragus is the lobule or lobe. If you palpate these structures on yourself, you should realize that the lobule is one of the few structures devoid of cartilage. The external auditory meatus, or the external acoustic meatus, is approximately 7 mm in diameter and 2.5 cm long when measured from the depth of the concha. But you would add another 1.5 cm to its length if you choose to measure it from the tragus. The external auditory meatus and conchae are resonating cavities that both contribute to hearing and are a major determinant of the resonance frequency. The lateral third of the canal is composed of cartilage and is about 8 mm long. The medial two-thirds is the bony meatus of the temporal bone. If you were to look into the ear canal, you would see that the outer third of the external auditory meatus is lined with hairs and has cerumen or earwax. These are both quite functional additions to the canal, as they trap insects and dirt, protecting the medial most point of the outer ear, the tympanic membrane. I'd like to add here an important clinical note associated to the external acoustic meatus. As you see, this structure does not follow a straight course. The observation of the external acoustic meatus and tympanic membrane in clinical examination requires what is known as a special tool known as otoscope, and can be improved by pulling the ear superiorly, posteriorly, and slightly laterally. Now, this type of examination is very important in cases of external otitis, or as it is widely known as the Stuermer's ear. This is a painful condition resulting from infection in the external acoustic meatus, and as the name indicates, it happens often to swimmers. The tympanic membrane, or eardrum, is a thin semi-transparent membrane which forms the partition between external acoustic meatus and middle ear. It's placed obliquely, making an angle of about 55 degrees with the floor of the external acoustic meatus. So the tympanic membrane faces downwards, forwards, and laterally as due to catch the sounds reflected from the ground. The tympanic membrane is made of three layers: the epithelial lining of the external acoustic meatus continues as the external layer of the tympanic membrane, while the lining of the middle ear provides the inner layer. Sandwiched between these two delicate epithelial lining is a layer of the fibrous tissue that provides a structure for the tympanic membrane. The tympanic membrane has a number of important landmarks. If you take the time to view one of your friend's tympanic membrane using an otoscope, of course carefully, you should see the ambo, which is the most distal point of attachment of inner tympanic membrane to one of the bones of the middle ear, the malleus. The tympanic membrane is particularly taut at this point, and the location inferior and anterior to this is referred to as the cone of light because it reflects the light of the audiologist's otoscope. You may be able to see the handle or meibomium of the malleus behind the tympanic membrane appearing as a streak on the membrane. If you are looking at the left tympanic membrane, the handle of the malleus should look like the handle of a clock pointing to the 11. The tympanic membrane is slightly concave when viewed from the external acoustic meatus, and the ambo is the most depressed portion of this concavity. Although most of the tympanic membrane is invested with the fibrous tissue, the pars flaccida is not, and this flaccid part may be seen in the superior quadrant of the tympanic membrane. On either side of the pars flaccida is a recess consisting of the anterior and posterior malleolar folds. These folds and the region at the cone of light are the result of the malleus pushing distally on the membrane. This tight bonding between membrane and malleus permits retransmission of acoustic energy from the tympanic membrane to the acicular chain. The middle ear is a small but extremely important space occupied by three of the smallest bones of the body. By birth, the middle ear is adult sized, and the ossicles and tympanic membrane are almost as large as they will ever be. First, let me examine these bones and their attachments, and then discuss the landmarks of the cavity itself. The bones of the ear, known as the ossicles, include the malleus, incus, and stapes. These ossicular chain of three articulated bones provide the means for transmission of acoustic energy impinging on the tympanic membrane to the inner ear. The malleus is the largest of the ossicles, providing the point of attachment with the tympanic membrane. The meibomium or handle of the malleus is a line process separated from the head by a thin neck. The anterior and lateral processes provide points of attachment for ligaments. The meibomium attaches to the tympanic membrane along its length, terminating with the lateral process. This attachment of the lateral process with the tympanic membrane forms the anterior and posterior malleolar folds and the pars flaccida, as we saw in the previous slide. The incus provides the intermediate communicating link of the ossicular chain. The malleus and incus articulate by means of a saddle joint, although it appears that the movement at the joint is quite limited. Rather, the malleus and incus appear to move as a unit upon movement of the tympanic membrane. The stapes or stirrup is the third bone of this chain. This is the smallest of the ossicles, and the foot blade or base of the stapes rests in the oval window of the temporal bone, held in place by the annular ligament. The articulation of the incus and the stapes, the incudostapedial joint, is of the ball and socket type. The ossicular chain is held in place by a series of strategically placed ligaments that suspend the ossicles from the walls of the middle ear cavity. Although the auditory ossicles and the tympanic membrane are responsible for the transmission of vibration, their activities are modified by two muscles. The stapedius muscle and the tensor tympani muscle are extremely important modulators of the hearing pathway. The stapedius is embedded in the bone of the posterior wall of the middle ear, which only its tendon emerging from the pyramidal eminence in the middle ear space, and inserts into the neck of the stapes. The muscle acts by pulling back the neck of the stapes, which indirectly pulls back the foot blade from the fenestra vestibuli or oval window. Innervation of stapedius is by facial nerve. Tensor tympani originate in a canal superior to the bony part of the pharyngotympanic tube, also known as the eustachian tube or auditory tube, and inserts into the handle of the malleus. As with the stapedius, only the tendon of the tensor tympani is found in the middle ear space. The muscle itself is housed in bone. The action of the muscle increases the concavity and rigidity of the tympanic membrane. Innervation of the tensor tympani is by the trigeminal nerve via the otic ganglion. Now we've examined the bones and their attachments, let's move on to discuss the landmarks of the cavity itself. The middle ear or tympanic cavity is air-filled and lined with a mucous membrane. The cavity of the middle ear can be subdivided into the tympanic cavity proper, which is opposite the tympanic membrane, and the epitympanic recess, which lies above the level of tympanic membrane. The middle ear communicates anteriorly with the nasopharynx through the auditory tube and posteriorly with the mastoid antrum and mastoid air cells through the auditus to the mastoid antrum. The middle ear is like a box with six sides. This is a drawing of the middle ear, and here the anterior wall is removed to provide this view and to help our discussion. So in here, you can see a roof, a floor, and posterior, medial, and lateral walls. Let us start off with the medial or labyrinthine wall, which you see here highlighted in purple. Medial wall separates the tympanic cavity from the internal ear. Thus, it is actually formed by the bony lateral wall of the internal ear. So, four landmarks related to the cochlea and the vestibular system lie immediately medial to the space. The oval window or fenestra vestibuli, in which the foot plate of the stapes is embedded, lies in the superior posterior aspect, and below that point is the round window, an opening sealed by the secondary tympanic membrane and marking the entrance into the scala tympani of the cochlea. Between these two is the promontory, a bulge created by the basal or first turn of the cochlea. Immediately above the oval window is the prominence of the lateral semicircular canal of the vestibular mechanisms. In addition to these landmarks, you can see the prominence of the facial nerve. Now let's talk about posterior wall, which you see highlighted in orange. The posterior wall separates the tympanic cavity from mastoid antrum and mastoid air cells. So superiorly, there is an opening or adytus through which the epitympanic recess communicates with the mastoid or tympanic antrum. Infection of the middle ear space may result in subsequent infection of the mastoid air cells, sometimes requiring mastoidectomy. Also, within the posterior wall, courses the chorda tympani, and the facial nerve prominence may be seen to continue on the medial wall. And finally, on the posterior wall is the prominence of the stapedial pyramid or pyramidal eminence, from which the tendon of the stapedius arises before attaching to the neck of the stapes. Another wall of the middle ear is seen here highlighted in blue, which is the lateral or membranous wall. As we discussed earlier, the lateral wall separates the middle ear from the external acoustic meatus and is formed mainly by the tympanic membrane along with the tympanic ring and sulcus, and partly by the squamous temporal bone in the region of the epitympanic recess. The roof or tegmental wall, highlighted in red, separates the middle ear from the middle cranial fossa. It is formed by a thin plate of bone called the tegment tympani. And the floor or jugular wall is formed by a thin plate of bone which separates the middle ear from the superior bulb of the internal jugular vein. This plate is part of the temporal bone too. Near the medial wall, the floor presents the tympanic canaliculus, which transmits the tympanic branch of the glossopharyngeal nerve to the medial wall of the middle ear. And finally, in this slide, you can see the anterior or carotid wall of the middle ear. The uppermost part of the anterior wall bears the opening of the canal for the tensor tympani. The middle part has the opening of the auditory tube, and the inferior part of the wall is formed by a thin plate of the bone which forms the posterior wall of the carotid canal. So the plate separates the middle ear from the internal carotid artery. The auditory tube, also known as the eustachian tube or the pharyngotympanic tube, as we discussed earlier, is basically a narrow canal that is located between the anterior wall of the middle ear and the lateral wall of the nasopharynx. This comprised of both bone and cartilage and is about 4 cm in length. The eustachian tube is closed under normal circumstances. However, in the cases where pressure needs to be equalized between the middle ear and the atmosphere, for example during takeoff in a plane when you fly, or for example when you scuba dive, the eustachian tube can open to then allow a small amount of air through. By doing so, this equalizes the pressure and prevents damage to your middle ear. The eustachian tube also functions to drain mucosa from the middle ear. So we've gone through the most important structures of external and middle ear. Now we are going to look at the internal ear or labyrinth. As you know, the internal ear lies in the petrous part of the temporal bone between the middle ear laterally and the internal acoustic meatus medially. And as I mentioned at the beginning of the lecture, all three parts of the ear are designed in such a way as to act as a transducer that converts the mechanical energy of the incoming sound wave into neuronal impulses that can be interpreted as sound. In addition, the inner ear also plays pivotal roles in maintaining postural balance and visual focus on a single object. Let's now focus on the labyrinth and look at the different anatomical landmarks of this part of the ear. The internal ear or labyrinth consists of a series of interlinked bony cavities, the bony labyrinth, and membranous ducts and sacs, or the membranous labyrinth within these cavities. Due to the size difference between the bony and membranous labyrinth, there is a space between two structures that is filled with a fluid known as perilymph. The lumen of membranous labyrinth consists another fluid known as endolymph. The internal ear can be divided into three general parts. First, we have the cochlear part, which is the auditory component and is concerned with hearing. Then we have the vestibular component, which deals with the balance while stationary. And finally, we have the semicircular component, which regulates balance while in motion. So now, let's look at the auditory component of the inner ear, the cochlea. The name cochlea comes from the Greek word for snake. And as you can see, the structure is a spiral coil like the shape of a snake. It twists 2.5 times opens itself around a central portion of bone called the modulus, producing a cone shape which points in an anterolateral direction. Branches from the cochlear portion of the vestibulocochlear nerve are found at the base of modulus. Extending outwards from the modulus is a ledge of bone known as a spiral lamina, which attaches to the cochlear duct, holding it in position. There are three chambers in the cochlea. The upper chamber, the scala vestibuli, begins at the vestibular window or oval window and extends to the apex of the cold cochlea. The lower chamber, the scala tympani, begins at the apex and terminates at the cochlear window or round window. Both the scala vestibuli and scala tympani are filled with pre-lymph. They are completely separate except at the narrow apex of the cochlea called the helicoterma, where they are continuous. Between the scala vestibuli and the scala tympani is the cochlear duct, the triangular middle chamber of the cochlea. The roof of the cochlear duct is called the vestibular membrane, and the floor is called the basilar membrane. The cochlear duct, which is filled with the endolymph, ends at the helicoterma. Within the cochlear duct is a specialized structure called the spiral organ or organ of Corti. The sound receptors that transform mechanical vibrations into nerve impulses are located along the basilar membrane of this structure, making it the functional unit of hearing. Hair cells situated near the helicoterma can best detect low-frequency sound. At the very base of the cochlea, there is an opening called the round window, which is the passage through the cochlea communicates with the medial ear. This opening is situated at the end of the scala tympani below the oval window and is closed off from the middle ear by a secondary tympanic membrane known as the round window membrane. So far, we've covered the cochlear part of the labyrinth. Now, it's time to move on and see the next part, the vestibule. The vestibule is the central portion of the bony labyrinth. It contains the vestibular or oval window into which the stapes fits, and the cochlear or round window on the opposite end. The membranous labyrinth within the vestibule consists of two connected sacs called the utricle and the saccule. The utricle is larger than the saccule and lies in the upper back portion of the vestibule, and it receives the ends of the three semicircular ducts through five openings. The duct of the saccule unites with the duct of the utricle to form the endolymphatic duct. The endolymphatic duct ends in the dilatation, the endolymphatic sac. Also, the saccule is connected to the cochlear duct via a small duct known as the ductus reunions. The medial walls of the saccule and utricle are thickened to form a macula in each chamber. The maculae are end organs that give information about the position of the head. They are static balance receptors. They are supplied by peripheral processes of neurons in the vestibular ganglion. Both the utricle and saccule contain receptors that are sensitive to gravity and the tilting of the head in the horizontal plane. Saccule gets stimulated by vertical linear motions, for example, going in lift. Utricle gets stimulated by horizontal linear motion, as an example, going in a car. Now, let's look at the third component of the labyrinth, the semicircular component. This part of the labyrinth is composed of three semicircular bony structures that project from the vestibule in three different directions. Each of these three bony canals contains perilymph and encloses a membranous semicircular duct filled with the endolymph. At one end of each semicircular canal, there is a dilation of the canal which is called the bony ampulla, and inside each bony ampulla, there is a corresponding membranous ampulla which contains a sensory organ known as the crista ampullaris. They are sensitive to angular acceleration and deceleration of the head as in rotational movement. The ampullae of three canals open into the vestibule independently. However, the non-ampullated ends at the anterior and posterior semicircular canals fuse to form the common bony crus. Similarly, the anterior and posterior membranous ducts fuse to form a membranous crus known as the common membranous crus. The common membranous crus opens into the utricle of the inner ear. The anterior semicircular duct is situated perpendicular to the temporal bone. The function of this canal is to detect rotations of the head in the sagittal plane. The lateral semicircular canal is situated in the horizontal direction and functions to detect rotations of the head in the transverse plane. For example, when we turn our heads looking to our left or looking to our right. And finally, the posterior semicircular canal runs parallel to the longitudinal axis of the petrous part of the temporal bone, and its function is to detect rotation of the head around the coronal plane or the anterior posterior axis. Now that we've looked at the membranous and bony structures of the labyrinth, let's move on to look at the nerves that are located in this part of the inner ear. The cochlear nerve is the branch of the vestibulocochlear nerve that carries the auditory sensory information from the cochlea directly to the brain. The cochlear nerve enters the base of the cochlea and is connected with the specific receptors of the spiral organ of Corti. The vestibular nerve is the other part of vestibulocochlear nerve. It carries spatial information from the semicircular canals and the vestibule to the brain. The vestibular nerve particularly transmits sensory information from the vestibular hair cells found on the utricle, saccule, and the semicircular canals via the vestibular ganglion. And finally, let's finish up today's discussion with a fantastic video about auditory transduction.
The sense of hearing is accomplished by a process known as auditory transduction. The ear converts sound waves in the air into electrical impulses, which can be interpreted by the brain. As sound enters the ear, it passes through the external auditory canal, where it meets the tympanic membrane. The tympanic membrane then vibrates in response to the sound. Sounds of a lower pitch, or frequency, produce a slower rate of vibration. And sounds of lower volume, or amplitude, produce a less dramatic vibration. Higher frequency sounds produce faster vibrations. The tympanic membrane is cone-shaped and articulates with a chain of three bones called the auditory ossicles. They consist of the malleus, the incus, and the stapes. The movements of the tympanic membrane vibrate the ossicles, passing on the information of frequency and amplitude. The three bones pivot together on an axis shown here in red. The pivotal axis is due to a series of ligaments which hold the bones in place within the middle ear cavity. The anterior malleal ligament and the posterior incutal ligament are of particular importance for the pivotal axis. Two structures which normally obscure this view of the middle ear have been removed. They are the chordae tympani nerve and the tendon of the tensor tympani muscle. Through the ossicles, the vibrations of the tympanic membrane are transferred to the footplate of the stapes. The stapes moves with a piston-like action, which sends vibrations into a structure called the bony labyrinth. The labyrinth is filled with a fluid called perilymph. If it were a completely closed and inflexible system, the movement of the stapes would be unable to displace the perilymph, and therefore unable to send vibrations into the bony structure. Due to the flexibility of a membrane called the round window, the stapes movement can displace the perilymph, allowing vibrations to enter the labyrinth. The corridor leading to the round window is found within the spiral portion of the bony labyrinth known as the cochlea. Vibrations produced by the stapes are drawn into the spiral system and return to meet the round window. The portion of the spiral passage in which vibrations ascend to the apex of the cochlea is called the scala vestibuli. The descending portion of the passage is called the scala tympani. A third structure, called the cochlear duct, is situated between the scala vestibuli and the scala tympani. The cochlear duct is filled with a fluid called endolymph, and when viewed in cross-section, the membranes separating the two fluid-filled systems are visible. They are Reissner's membrane and the basilar membrane. The membranes are flexible and move in response to the vibrations traveling up the scala vestibuli. The movements of the membranes then send vibrations back down to the scala tympani. A specialized structure called the organ of Corti is situated on the basilar membrane. As the basilar membrane vibrates, the organ of Corti is stimulated, which sends nerve impulses to the brain via the cochlear nerve. The actual nerve impulses are generated by specialized cells within the organ of Corti called hair cells. The hair cells are closely covered by a structure called the tectorial membrane. As the basilar membrane vibrates, the tiny clusters of hairs are bent against the tectorial membrane, triggering the hair cells to fire. The entire basilar membrane does not vibrate simultaneously. Instead, specific areas along the basilar membrane move variably in response to different frequencies of sound. Lower frequencies vibrate the basilar membrane closer to the apex of the cochlea, whereas higher frequencies produce vibrations closer to the base. This arrangement is known as tonotopic organization. Together, this sequence of events is responsible for our acoustic perception of the world around us.